Amen. Amen. Well, guys, if you have your Bible, can I get you to open to Genesis chapter 32? Genesis 32. I figured out I wanted to start the church off in the right direction. And so we tricked y'all. That sounds good, doesn't it? Because we started with a series called Lose Weight, Get Out of Debt, and Start Over. Okay? Let me tell you this. At our church, the most important thing is not your size. It's not your financial status. It's how much Jesus do you have? Amen. But the reality is that we live in a real world with real needs, with real things going on. We have real frustrations, and sometimes we need some real things to change. Can I get an amen to that? And so what we wanted to do was do a series that didn't just talk about and deal with those specific issues of losing weight and getting out of debt. We will deal with those. But the most important thing that we can give you is life change. Because let me tell you this, we talked about this in some of our soft launch services as we led up to this point. This is that time of year when everyone makes resolutions. They make resolutions because they're frustrated and the beginning of a year starts and it's a chance to start over. And so because of that, we make these resolutions. But how many of us have ever not made it to the end of January before the resolution stopped? Mm-hmm. Anybody ever made it to January 7th and by the seat, you're like, I'm done. This ain't gonna work. You know, I tried the keto diet. We got a guy here that's on it and he recommended it to me. I've made it 2 days. He's like, you gotta make it to the third day. I said, you know what, I'm not Jesus, okay? 3 days don't apply to me, okay? I was done with it. But we wanna see real change that lasts and makes a difference in your life. And so we're doing a series called Lose Weight, Get Out of Debt, and Start Over, a series about life change, amen? Genesis chapter 32, and we're gonna go to verse 24. And it says this. Genesis 32, 24. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When he saw that he had not prevailed against him, he touched the socket of his thigh so that the socket of Jacob's thigh was dislocated while he wrestled with him. Then he said, let me go, for the dawn is breaking. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Anybody ever been so desperate that you hold on to something, you say, I will not let you go until you bless me. So he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. He said, your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with man and have prevailed. Then Jacob asked him and said, please tell me your name. But he said, why is it that you ask my name? And he blessed him there. So Jacob named the place Peniel, for he said, I have seen God face to face. Yet my life has been preserved. Now the sun rose upon him just as he crossed over Peniel, and he was limping on his thigh. Therefore, to this day, the sons of Israel do not eat the sinew of the hip, which is on the socket of the thigh, because he touched the socket of Jacob's thigh in the sinew of the hip. Today, we're going to talk about the topic of no pain, no gain. No pain, no gain. Let's pray. Father God, we just come before you right now. We ask that you would move and stir in this place. God, you brought the people. You woke them up this morning. You put energy in their bodies. You moved them here. And God, we know that you don't do things by happenstance. So God, today, would you move? Would you stir? Would your Holy Spirit just well up in us and allow transformation to take place to the point that we can't quantify it, we can't explain it, we just enjoy it, and we just praise you for it, oh God. We need you to move in this place. We need you to restore us, oh God. We need you to rebuild us, renew us, revive us, God. We need a remix in our life, oh God. It's been getting stale, and now we need some change. So God, would you do exceedingly and abundantly above anything we ask or think of? Right now, I ask that you would remove me from the equation, that you would speak for yourself, because I am inadequate to do that which you've tasked me to do. So God, in the gap between the assignment and the person, would you fill the gap? Would you make the difference? Would you make the way? And it's in the mighty, matchless, and wonderful name of our glorious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. And all God's children say, amen. And amen. You may be seated. Guys, if you have some room, we have some seats available in the middle. If you don't mind moving up, we want to make sure that people coming in can come in. So we do have a few more seats. But we thank you for being here. We thank you for being here. If you consider yourself an honest person, raise your hand. All right. Amen. Amen. Good. Good. We got a half honest church today. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. That's pretty normal church. That's why I'm okay with it. Okay. Y'all didn't catch that yet. So if we're honest, Anybody ever put up a facade as to how well you were doing? But in reality, behind the facade, behind the mask, things were crumbling, things were frustrating, you weren't as happy as you could be. Anybody ever been that person before? Is it just me? See, I'm gonna keep it real today. As a preacher, I've been preaching for 15 years now, and as a preacher, here's one of the things I learned about people that you preach to. It's funny, they want the word, but they really don't want the person. Because the reality is this, people want you to give a good message and say that you have it all together, but the truth is that most of us who preach are just barely hanging on the same way as everybody else. Let's take all of that other stuff out the way. So guys, I am a work in progress, preaching to works in progress. Amen. So if I say something, don't get surprised. Guess what? I need Jesus the same way you need Jesus. It's funny that in churches, the person who gets the least ministry of Jesus is usually the pastor. But we're going to leave that for another one. But we all got some issues. We all have some problems. And I wonder what your problems are. See, most of us in a crowded room, we would not admit what our issues are. But if we were one-on-one with somebody, would we admit what our issues are, what we're struggling with, what we want to change? I want you to think about that. Or are you so caught up in that thing and so in bondage to that thing that even if you were in a room by yourself and no one else was in the four walls, there was no speaker, there was no microphone, and no one could hear you, could you even admit to yourself that you got stuff that needs to change? Because sometimes we struggle. Sometimes it hurts us that there's things about us that fail, that don't go the way we want them to go. And so in order to cope with that, we don't even want to admit that we have problems. But let me tell you the truth. In this world today, everybody's got some issues. Look at your neighbor and say, everybody's got some issues. All right. I want to talk about some of the issues in America right now, because I think there's some things that need to change. I was looking up some statistics, and when it comes to finance, did you know that only 30% of Americans have a long-term financial plan that includes savings and investment goals? 30%. That means 70% have no clue what they're doing. Amen. Do you know you're most likely to budget if you make at least $75,000 a year? And since the national average of income is less than that, the average person doesn't budget. Okay. 19% have saved $0 to cover an emergency expense, and 31% of people have less than $500 in emergency savings. 49% of Americans have said to feel that they feel concerned, anxious, or fearful about their current financial well-being, okay? And watch this. Low income is not always to blame for your financial hardships. Only 1 in 5 people facing financial hardship fall below the poverty line. That means there are people who are making money and have money, but they just don't know what to do with the money, so they're still hurting in money. That's just finances. What about marriages right now? What about the fact that in our country, 51% of people are divorcing? 51% of married couples are saying, I give up the ghost. We are out. I don't want nothing to do with you. You don't want nothing to do with me. We're going to quit this thing right now. 51%. Watch this. Do you realize that right now in 7 states, more than 35% of people are struggling with obesity? Stay with me. In 29 states, over 25%. That means we are in a country where people are overweight, they're broke, and they're unhappy in their homes. Isn't that a problem? Let me tell you today, it doesn't matter who you are. There are some things that need to change. But the problem is that most of us, we try to change on our own. We try to use the wrong methods for change. How many of y'all, if you set up that resolution, you went to the library, you got a self-help book, you took a class, you did all of these different steps, and at the end of the day, there was still no change in your current predicament. Anybody ever been there before? Anybody ever have something, you're not proud to say it, but you got something that you struggle with, and you haven't struggled with it for a day, a week, or a month. You struggle with it for a year, or 2 years, or 5 years, or 10 years. Do I got anybody that's ever struggled with something for a long time? They tried to beat it, they tried to slay it, but that thing kept plaguing them. So we got real things that we need to deal with, but we need to figure out what do we have to do to make real change, okay? So here's what I want us to do. I want us to look at what is the real process for change. I want us to think about that. And let me tell you, it starts with this. What are you really trying to change? And what are you really trying to solve? What are you really trying to do? Before I get to the points, I want to ask you this. How many of y'all have ever experienced a time like this before where the seasons are fluctuating? One day is 70 degrees, the next day is 30 degrees, the next day is 70 degrees, the next day is 20 degrees. How many of y'all ever been through that before? And then the next thing you know, you along with everybody else are in the aisle at the local pharmacy and you're trying to find something that will fix what's happening to your body because you're in the middle of all these changes, right? So when we do that, we go there and the first thing we do is we go up to the counter and say, can you tell me what to get? And they say, what's your problem? And you say, I got a sore throat, I got a headache, I got a cough, my body aches, and they're like, ooh, you in trouble. right? So they walk out, they come out from behind the counter, they go over there, they start handing you box after box after box. Next thing you know, they're saying, here's some, Theraflu, right? And here's some Alka-Seltzer cold and flu. Here's some Robitussin, right? Here's some Dimetapp. They start handing you all this different stuff because you've told them, these are my problems. And so what they're doing is they're handing you a box of something to treat those problems, right? Well, here's the issue. Anybody ever took that same medicine, took all the medicines at the same time, and when it was all done, you still felt just as bad or worse than you did before you took the box of medicine? The reason that happens is because you're treating the symptoms and not the problems. You're treating the symptoms. Guess what? Yes, you have a sore throat. Yes, it's a real reality. Yes, it's hurting you. Yes, you can't swallow. But let me tell you something. If you get to the root of that sore throat, there's something deeper that's bugging you. And if you learn how to deal with that, the sore throat won't bother you anymore. But here's the thing. If you treat the sore throat, guess what? You still got a bigger problem on the inside. Do y'all realize that, guess what? There are some things, colds and flus, that you cannot treat with medicine because the problem is not the sore throat. It's a viral infection. And so some of us got to realize that, guess what? The issues that we're having, whether it's financial, whether it's emotional, whether it's relational, okay, whether it's in our physical health, whatever it is, we got to stop treating the symptoms and start getting to the root of the problems. I mean, let me tell you something. Most of us, we try to go throw money at something. We try to do research. We try to get help. But the truth is this. You can't treat spiritual problems with earthly methods. And that's the problem, because most of us don't realize, guess what? I'm about to say something. We're about to slay some folks today, including myself, okay? I already know what my body fat percentage is, and I'm working on it, so I'm proud to preach today, amen? I ain't there yet, okay? But we getting there, amen? So here's the reality. I'm preaching to myself, not just to y'all, okay? All right, I still got 32 pounds I'm working on, okay? So don't get mad, but let me tell you this. Sometimes your obesity is not a matter of just a table issue. It's a matter of a spiritual issue. Guess what? Sometimes your financial issue is not the fact that you don't make enough. It's that you don't know how to handle it because there's something wrong in your spirit that's going on. Guess what? Sometimes your marriage is not that y'all are unequally yoked. Okay, we're not talking about that. If y'all both saved, then guess what? Y'all are equally yoked. It's not that y'all have different hobbies and stuff like that. No, guess what? Sometimes it's got to do with the fact that you are broken just like that other person is broken, and two broken things don't fix anything. It's a spiritual issue. And we got to learn that, guess what? In order to change these things that are going on, we got to get to the bottom of our spiritual problems. And so how do we make this life change happen? I want to look at the story of Jacob, because Jacob's story is one of the most dramatic transformational moments that happens in all of Scripture. We got a man who was a mess, okay? He was an absolute mess. From the moment that Jacob was conceived, he was in the womb scheming. Y'all ever met anybody like that? From the moment they were born, they were scheming. Before they came out the womb, they were scheming. You wake up in the morning, I know you're scheming something. They just evil. That was Jacob. He was a deceiver. His name literally meant deceiver or supplanter. As he was coming out of the womb, he had a brother, twin brother Esau, and Esau was coming out first. Guess what Jacob did? He grabbed and clutched onto his heel. What that meant, he was trying to pull him back in so he could get out first. You ever know somebody that wouldn't want to pull you back in just so they can try to get ahead? Let me tell you this. Crabs in a barrel don't work. Crabs in a barrel does not work. The problem is none of y'all get out. I'm going to leave that for another day, though. I'm going to leave that for another day. So here's the reality. That was his nature. And so as he got older, that deceitful nature expanded to the point that as he got older, he made his brother sell his birthright for a cup of soup. If your brother is hungry, do you feed them or do you say, I will feed you, but the cost is going to be the very blessing that you were born into? Some of us got some siblings that, guess what? I won't even go there. Y'all don't even want to know that. But that's the reality. That's how he was. So not only did he take his birthright, but then near the death of his father, the birthright was one set of things, but then there was also a prayer blessing that would go over a child, and it would be like a father's extended blessing to that firstborn child. And guess what? When he had the opportunity, he not only took the birthright, but he said, I want to take your blessing. What's it like when somebody that says they love you, but all they really want to do is take your blessing? That's a whole nother thing. That's how conniving. He didn't care about other people. He cared about himself. If it couldn't benefit him, he wasn't worried about it. I promise I'm going somewhere. That was his nature. Guess what? He needed a nature change. If he ever wanted to look like and be like and walk like the God that he said he knew and served, he couldn't continue in the same path, doing the same things the same way and expecting something different. But you know what had to happen to him? He had to mess over the wrong person. Because the person that he messed over was his brother, the skilled hunter, the killer, the one who went out and killed game for a hobby. You know, the dude that went hunting on the weekends. All right. And his brother was so upset at what Jacob did that he wanted to kill him. Jacob had to flee. And while he was on the run, he continued to do scandalous things. But let me tell you, there's a time and a place where everything comes full circle. Anybody know that? You might have thought you were okay. You might have thought, guess what, I got away with it. But there is always a time and a place where things come full circle. And Jacob came to a place where now he had to leave where he was and go back home. Sometimes we got to go back home. But his reality was this. All of the problems that his deceitful nature had caused were now, they were no longer behind him. They were in front of him. And so he had to deal with that, because if he didn't deal with that before he saw his brother would take his life with no question. And so when we get to Genesis 32, what we're seeing is the moment a man has to wrestle with God. The moment a man has to say, you know what? I can't do this by myself. The things and the issues are so deep within me that guess what? I can't fix myself. Can the dishwasher fix itself? I've seen a self-cleaning oven, but I've never seen a self-fixing oven. If my fridge could fix itself, I wouldn't be prepared to go out and buy a new fridge. But guess what? Things can't fix themselves from the inside. There will always be an external force that goes into it and helps to make the repairs necessary for that thing to thrive and survive. And guess what? Some of us, we need that external force. Let me tell you up front, that external force is God. It is God in the person of Jesus Christ. But let's go into the text right now. Genesis 32. Starting at verse 24. And actually, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go back to verse 22, and it says this. Now he arose that same night, took his two wives and his two maids and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and he sent across whatever he had. And then I'm going to look at the first few verses of 24, and it says this. Then Jacob was left alone. The first thing I want to tell you today is this. The closer you are, the harder things get. The closer you are, the harder things get. Now, why do I say this? Because when you look in this text, it seems like there might not be a lot going on, but there's a lot of information in here that's very important for us to understand the grasp of what's going on. It says this, that now he had come to a point where he's at the ford of the Jabbok, which is like a little tributary of water, like a little river of water that flows into a bigger body, okay? And so he's sitting here, and what he does is he sends his family over, his wives, his children, all his possessions, the things that he was going to try to butter up his brother and bless him with when he go, and now he's left alone. And for us, we're like, okay, he's there. But let me tell you something that I want y'all to do. I'm going to teach y'all how to exposit some text, okay? Y'all ready for this? When the Bible gives you a name of something, you always need to know what that name is for. Sometimes when the Bible is naming a place and it gives you the name, they're telling you that because that place has a biblical importance. Like if you were to see the name Bethel, it would mean like house of God or place of God. And what that might mean is this. Guess what? That this is a place that we already know God has started working in. Okay, when you come to Bethel, you know what? The presence of God is here. They call this the house of God because God is known to do some big and amazing things when you get to Bethel. But sometimes it's not about what the name of the place is. It's about its geographical location. And when we sit here, we're looking at this and it says that it's at the ford of Jabbok. And what's important about this and why this is important is because the Jabbok flows in to the Jordan River. Now, let me help you understand this, okay? It flows into the Jordan River. Why is that important? Because it's at the Jordan where a lot of amazing things of God took place. Stay here with me, all right? You're going to see this. When Joshua and the Israelites would later cross the Jordan on dry ground to the Promised Land. See, the Jordan was the border of the Promised Land. And so when they needed to cross over, God moved the waters out the way so they could walk through on dry land. And guess where he did that? At the Jordan. Somebody say at the Jordan. All right, when Naaman was healed of leprosy, he was healed where? Guess what? At the Jordan. When Elisha made an axe handle float on the top of the water, guess where it was? It was at the Jordan. Watch this. And when that was Elisha. And when Elijah was taken up into heaven after crossing the Jordan, guess what? And it was the Jordan River where Jesus was baptized. There was a lot of important stuff that happened at the Jordan. And guess what? Sometimes it can get close, but now he's at a point where he's about to come face to face with God and have to wrestle with God. And let me tell you, it's going to get hard before you get in. It's going to get hard before you cross the threshold into your promise. Sometimes you have to realize that, guess what? Right when I'm on the cusp of my promise is when my greatest battles are going to happen. And see, sometimes we get frustrated and we quit too quickly because we get there and things start getting heavy and they start getting rough and we start getting tired. We're tired of crying. We're tired of the fighting. We're tired of battling. We're tired of it all. And what you don't realize, if you would just let the fog clear for a couple minutes, you might realize that your promised land is right there. He was right on the edge of promise. And let me tell somebody today, you're frustrated, you're tired, you're weary, you're broken. But let me tell you, maybe you are that way because you're right on the edge of promise. You're so close to a place where God can put his hands on you and bless you, but you got to press on just a little bit longer. You got to put your big boy pants on, stand up, get your boxing gloves on and say, I'm still ready to fight. We can't give up. So many stories of people giving up and the finish line was right there. Don't give up. Don't give up, y'all. It's going to get harder the closer you get. Don't know that. If they tell you it gets easier, it's a lie. And guess what? It's a lie from the pit of hell because they want you to be disturbed and upset when it doesn't get easy so you can quit. But it's going to get a little rougher. But I promise that your blessing is going to be in that last battle. All right, y'all ready? But the second thing I want you to learn about this after this text is that it's got to go through God. All of these things are speaking to life change. What is the process of life change? Here's the truths of life change. One, guess what? It's going to get harder before you get your blessing. And I'm not one of the people. You'll learn me. God is a blesser. He says that those who please him must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So he blesses people. So when you hear me saying blessing, I'm not talking about it in some ulterior prosperity way. I'm talking about the fact that God in his nature is a blesser, okay? And so before you bless, it's going to get hard. Before he blesses you, it's going to get hard. But watch this. Before he blesses you, it's got to go through him. How many of us have tried to circumvent the will of God to see our problems changed? Guess what? I promise I ain't preaching that nobody, but they have this class called Financial Peace, what we agree with, and we say, hey, we want to send people to financial peace, right? We want you to help learn this. But let me tell you this. Financial peace can only teach you some of the tangible methods about how to manage your money. Now, what he's trying to do is also help you realize that the only way you're going to make it through these principles the right way is if God is behind you. See, here's the truth. Guess what? The methods won't do anything. It's got to go through God. Look at your neighbor. Tell him it's got to go through God. It's gotta go through God. Let me tell you this, any blessing that's worth having, any life change that's worth having has to go through God. Stop thinking you can do it by yourself, for yourself, because it was you, yourself, and you that got you in the problem in the first place. Maybe I'm the only one who has a natural ability to walk themselves into trouble and need the grace of God to rescue them. Maybe it's just me, but that's the truth. Some things only have to go through God. And so look at the text. It says, then Jacob was alone and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. Here is what's important. It said a man, right? Now, theologically, what we understand this person to be was the angel of the Lord. And this was called a theophany. It was a pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus Christ. What that means is this, is that if you don't know it, Jesus Christ has always existed. He did not have a birth date, even though he was born through Mary. He existed before time. And guess what? He will exist forevermore. He has always been. And so even before he came through the birth canal of Mary, Jesus existed. That's why there would be times and places in the Old Testament where the angel of the Lord would show up and he would do something, and that was Jesus. This man that he was wrestling with was Jesus. Jesus saw that Jacob had such issues that he could not solve himself, that he decided to divinely intervene himself into the affairs of Jacob to make sure that there could be real change that happens. Somebody don't catch that. That's called a shadow, a foreshadowing of something that was going to happen later. There's another man in scripture, let me tell you about this, who saw that we had a problem, okay? And so what he did was he decided to intervene himself into the affairs of humanity. So he came through the birth canal of Mary, lived a sinless life for 33 years, and then was slaughtered on a cross to be the atoning sacrifice for sin. When we couldn't pay the debt that we needed paid, there was a man named Jesus on a hill called Calvary on a old wooden cross, and he gave his life for you and me. That is the truth. That's why this is important, because what Jacob is teaching us is that he was showing us a foreshadowing of what would need to happen in our own lives. Guess what? It's got to go through God. If you want change that's going to last, it's got to go through God. Why? Because your self-help thing is going to expire. The book is going to be outdated in 2 years, and they're going to update the copy with some new methods, and those steps ain't going to work anymore. But guess what? When you attach yourself to the God who is over time, greater than time, who exists forever and ever, when your problems are going on, guess what? You attach yourself to him, and he gives you a solution. That solution is eternal. It's got to go through God. Somebody say it's got to go through God. That's the second thing I want you to know. It's got to go through God. But here's the third thing I want you to get. In order to have this real effective life change, you must grasp hold of God like your life depends on it. Like your life. You must grasp hold of God because your life depends on it. Not like because. Let me tell you this. Eternal life can only come through Jesus Christ our Lord. So if you're not willing to grab hold of Jesus, then guess what? That's what we believe. So here's the reality. Let's look at the text and see what happens. It says, then Jacob was left alone, and a man who we know was this pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus wrestled with him until daybreak. And when he saw that he had not prevailed, I want you to think about this. This was the night when Jacob began wrestling with Jesus. And it was still daybreak, and Jacob is still wrestling with Jesus. See, most of the time, we want it quick, fast, in a hurry. We are the Burger King generation. You can have it your way. But when it's going with God, you can't just have it your way. It's got to be His way. Stop thinking that you make the rules. Unless you wrote the game, you don't make the rules. If you are not the maker of it, you don't make the rules. Look, tell somebody else, you don't make no rules. Now, in your home, if you own the home, you bought the home, you paid the rent, they your children, guess what? You make the rules. Child, get your butt in the bed at 8:30, and if I hear you at 8:31, it's going to be trouble, trouble, right? Because we are in charge of that. Well, guess what? God is the author of time and creation. I love what it says in Hebrews, fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. That is the reality of who He is. So now, if He is the author of time and space and earth and people and everything that has ever been done, and the Bible tells us that all things were created by Jesus and for Jesus. If He is that, doesn't that mean that He has the right to make the rules? So He's saying it's not going to come easy. If you want to get it, it's going to take some wrestling in your life. Some of us need to get some backbone, because what we want is we want it quick. We're the internet generation, but some of us grew up and we had Encyclopedia Britannica. It wasn't Wikipedia. It was World Book. We had a set of World Books in our house, okay? And I remember that because we would have a project for school and we had to really search that thing out. I didn't realize I was that old until I realized I was that old. Because I tried to tell my daughter, I'm like, go to the library and go to the encyclopedia. And she just, what is that? They got libraries in school? I mean, it was really like that. But there's a reality. It's kind of like cooking. Who in here likes to cook? Who in here can cook? Let's try that again. Raise your hand if you could cook. Now, Linda's my neighbor. I know she could cook because, bless her heart, she would come over with all kind of stuff and we'd be praising God when we close that door. Amen? There's people that can cook in life, right? And then there's people who can bake in life, right? But then there's some people who can microwave. Y'all ain't know anybody that's a microwave chef? There's, amen. Hey, you eat, don't you? You're healthy. But here's the difference. Watch. Is the Stouffer's lasagna as good as the homemade lasagna? Is the McDonald's as good as Grandma's Thanksgiving? Sometimes. You know them hot fries. Y'all know we all, Jesus 2019, I'm trying to give them up. But here's the reality. There's something that happens when you go through the time-taking process. Now, one of my favorite things to do is to start cooking. I'm a cook, so I would start, if it's Thanksgiving, I'm gonna start on Wednesday, and I start cooking. I start making all kind of stuff. This year, I made truffle macaroni and cheese with Parmesan crumbles on it. Right, so I did this. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Okay, sorry. I made that, right? And so that's not the kind of thing you want to make on Thanksgiving Day. What you want to actually do is start cooking the day before. You know why? Because once you've put it together and you've cooked it, you put it into the fridge. And what begins to happen? That stuff, the flavors begin to come together like boom, right? Y'all ever been there? Anybody ever had a second day dressing? Y'all know second day dressing. Yes, Lord. I don't even need to come. So just Thank you, Jesus. There's something. It's good on Thanksgiving, right? But Friday, when it's had a little more time. See, that's the reality of how God works. He doesn't want it quick in us because he wants the flavors right. Why? Because we're supposed to be a sweet aroma in his nostrils. He wants when that thing heats up that he can smell it and it's pleasing to him. So what he's trying to do is work on the inside of us. Let everything come together. Let the flavors and the character come together so that when he sees you, he can say, well done. Well done. And so what had to happen was Jacob had to wrestle, but it wasn't no pay-per-view WWE three-hour thing. This was an overnight battle. Has anybody ever wrestled with God overnight about something before? Anybody ever had something that plagued you so much that in the middle of the night it woke you up out your sleep and you could do nothing but bend your knees at the foot of your bed and put your face in the mattress because it troubles you? See, that's what it means to wrestle with God. It means that you're sitting there and you're taking your issues and you're asking him, run it through your filter, God. Run it through your mind, God. Run it through your heart, God. I'm going to take it to you, and you're the processor. I'm going to put it in you, and I'm not going to take it back until I've gotten it and you've put your imprint on it. My troubles, I'm going to give them to you, and I'm going to let you process them and show me what is your mind towards my troubles. What is your heart towards my troubles? What are your feelings, God? How should I be thinking about this? And sometimes when you get things back from God, you wonder, why did I even worry about it in the first place? See, what he does is he transforms our thinking. That's why the Bible says, be no longer conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve God's good, pleasing, and perfect will for your life. See, we got to wrestle with God. You want weight loss? You need to wrestle with God. Guess what? You may not only just lose some weight, but you might lose some flaws in the same time. When you wrestle with God, see, this is why we don't like to wrestle with God, because we want what we want. When we want it, how we want it. If you wrestle with God before you go in the furniture store and buy that couch, you might not buy that couch. I'm talking to a couple I was talking to the other day. They were like, I want to get a mattress. I want to get a mattress. I want to get a mattress. And they called me and said, should we get this mattress? I said, tell me about it. They were like, the mattress is this many, and it has zeros behind it. Not like one, not like two, but like, you know, and I'm like, do y'all got the same Sam's Club membership that I got? I was like, for real, you can go up there and get this for this. And somebody got mad at me for a second. They got mad at me for a second. And it was funny, but that person called me back later and said, thank you. They were like, but I had to wrestle with the fact that the real problem was that I really wanted what I wanted when I wanted it. And I thought that was such an awesome growing point that they took that thing to God, and all of a sudden the transformation began to happen. And the next day their thinking was different than the day before. That's what it means. Some of us need to take the very things we're struggling with and actually process them through the mind of God. And let's say you feel like you can't hear the mind of God. It speaks loudly and it's right here. Some of us need to get on our knees after reading the scripture and allow God to speak. It don't happen quickly. It doesn't happen in a moment. But guess what? It's more savory when it does. God doesn't care about the contents of that stuff. He cares about your character. He ain't worried about stuff. He's worried about your salvation. That's why he says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Finally, final point after you must hold God like your life depends on it is this. God will always leave his marks on you. This is the hardest point to preach, because Jacob wrestled with God to see his nature change, and God changed his nature from one whose name was deceiver to Israel. He became the father of Israel. The 12 tribes were what? His kids, right? They always talk about the 12 tribes. That was from his seed. Whenever they named the country Israel. It's still to this day named what? Israel. If God could change your name and your character to the point that it would live on, he could do something monumental. What cost would you pay? I want you to look at a cost to value. Those things that you struggle with, how much are they worth? Because there's a price that has to be paid for everything. Jacob would walk the rest of his life with a limp. If you had to walk with a cane the rest of your life, but you could carry Christ with you the rest of your life, would it be worth it? I never really pull this thing out like this, but the Spirit of the Lord is telling me. So on my arm are two long surgical scars. Because when I was running from God and saying, God, I want to do this and do that, and I wanted a career, and it sounds funny, but I wanted to be a pro bowler. So I averaged about 230, and I bowled somewhere around 20 to 30 games a day from the time I was 16. To the point where I said, hey, I'm gonna even take a career, I'm gonna learn how to fix the machine. So I was one of the youngest mechanics on most machines in the city. And so one day I'm working on a machine, call comes in to fix the machine, I go back to the machine, I hit the power switch, the lights go off. But what I didn't know is that my boss had hotwired the power switch so that it would stay on. And so I turned it off and I put my hand in to start fixing the machine, and the machine came back and it snapped my arm in half. And then all of a sudden the machine decided to shut off. And my arm was left trapped in the machine. And 10 minutes went by, 20 minutes went by, 30 minutes went by, 40 minutes went by. And I'm behind 22 loud decibel machines, so no one could hear my screams. And I knew what was happening in that moment. When people would have gone into shock, they say, I didn't lose my sanity. And I began to cry. Y'all ever cried about something? Y'all mean really cried? You know the ugly face crying? Because it's hit you to the point of desperation. And so I began to cry, but it wasn't just crying because I was in pain. I was crying because I needed a rescuer. I was in the middle of a dilemma that I could not fix by myself. And I began to cry for help. And I said, Jesus, if you get me out of this, I haven't listened to you. I haven't focused on you. I haven't obeyed you. And I got myself in this. But Jesus, can you help me? If you help me, I'll walk with the marks. I'll live with the scars. But I'll do what you want me to do. And at the moment, I mean, within the millisecond that I prayed that prayer, the cashier from the front walked around the corner and saw me trapped in the machine. This woman who had no experience on a machine came over, and I was able to direct her on what to do so that she could cycle the machine and get it off of my arm. And they took me to the hospital. Ambulance came, and they thought I was gonna lose my arm. And so they immediately stuck a large needle in there, they drained the blood out, and they took me into emergency surgery. And that was the last of consciousness I had that day. But I woke up the next day, and I couldn't feel my arm. But what I was able to see was this giant cast on my arm. And what it meant was that even though things had been so bad, there was still hope. Today I want to challenge you to guess what? God is the giver of hope. And you may be struggling with some things. Your finances may be crumbling right now, and you're in the middle of problems that you're too embarrassed to tell somebody, but God is the God of hope. Your marriage may be struggling right now, and you don't know what to do, if y'all are gonna sleep in the same bed another day, if somebody's gonna sleep in the same house, are y'all even gonna stay together? How will I live if something happens? He's the God of hope. Has your child been going crazy and you don't know what to do? He's the God of hope. Is it your health? Because he's healed before. And so today I want to challenge you. It may mean some marks, it may mean some pains, but if he could work it out in your life, would the marks be a fair cost? You know, one thing we never see in the scriptures, never once see a complaint from Jacob about the limp that he carried for the rest of his life. And you know why? Because there was no more Jacob when God got done. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you right now, and we ask that you would begin to move. Some of us are struggling with some things, but we've been treating symptoms and not problems. Today we ask that you would just begin to turn our hearts to you and say, God, you know what? We're gonna look at this in a different way, with a different lens. So God, today I pray for healing for someone, for victory for someone, for finances for someone. But most importantly, I pray for the life change that can only come through you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.